So what I'd like to do tonight is introduce you to some of the research that my colleagues and my graduate students and I have done around the Seattle area. It's very relevant to what's been done here in Portland as well by Michael Murphy and some of his students as well. They've done very similar things. So there's a lot of parallels. We live in the same basic kind of area. And I think the results that we got are absolutely transferable to the sorts of things that have been found here and that you guys will be dealing with here as well. I want to start off with a typical animal that we see in our suburban backyards in Seattle. I'm sure you've all seen the Baird's tapir here as well. It's probably very common as probably around Sturgeon Lake, I would imagine. Yeah, they like that kind of habitat. But this animal actually is the type of animal that does not do well in urban areas at all. It is what we call an avoider species. It declines when people are around. This is an animal that lives in Corcovado National Park in Costa Rica. And places like that, big reserves that are put up to save animals like this and exclude people, really, for the most part. You can go there as a visitor, but you can't live there. Places like that, I think, critically depend upon the values that we develop in places like this, where we live and work. And that's really the central message that I want to get across to you tonight, is that there's a lot of great things happening in your own backyard, and two, the appreciation of those, and especially spreading the appreciation of those with those who are not so keen on animals, might help build some willingness to sacrifice on behalf of places and animals like the Baird's tapir and Corcovado. So I'll come back to that at the end. This is probably a much more familiar scene to you here. It's very familiar to us in Seattle, where we have new subdivisions going in quite frequently into forested areas. And we were concerned really with what happens with the birds and the other animals, but I'll focus on birds tonight that lived in this once contiguous forest that's now abutting developments or is fragmented and punctuated by new roads and buildings and people that go in. So as we talk about things tonight, imagine yourself as a small bird living in a place maybe that was right here, and it was a nice forested setting where you once were, and then one day it's cleared like that. What are your options? What do you do? What is it affect in terms of the population? And as you might expect, when we started counting birds around the Seattle area, we would go out and we'd stand at points and count all the birds we could see or hear within a fixed distance from us. That's a pretty standard research technique. And we basically, as people say, we just go bird watching each morning, write down what we see, and we record it in various places that are at different distances or different amounts of vegetation, natural vegetation, from Seattle. So this is the kind of curve you might expect to see. And what we're showing here is basically the number of bird species on the y-axis, or the richness we call it, or sometimes you might hear it referred to as diversity. So number of species of unique kinds of birds as a function of how much forest there is around the place where we counted them. So these are places on this end where there's very little, if any, forest. These are downtown Seattle and Everett. It could be downtown Portland. I think you get a very similar result. And then we go to places that are increasingly forested in the landscape around. 40 or 50% in kind of suburban settings that you might expect, like the one I just showed you, on up to 80 or 100% in reserves that are set around for our watershed protection, basically, in the Seattle area. This increase is what we expected to see, and we expected to see it continue from this point on out into the reserves that are pretty much all forested. But in fact, we saw this. This is the result of our studies. And what we see is a decline in abundance, or a decline in the variety of species of birds as we get away from these moderately settled areas into reserves of forest only. So places like, if you're familiar, the Cedar River Watershed Reserve or Kirkland Watershed Reserve, they're big, several hundred acre, if not more, second growth natural fir and hemlock forests and cedar. Okay, so diversity declines again. It doesn't get as low as over here in the urban area by a long shot, but the real peak in diversity is here in the center, in what I'm going to talk about tonight and what we call in the book Subirdia. So it's a place where there's the greatest richness of species of birds, and we were interested in determining, is that sustainable? Are those birds doing okay there? And if not, what could we do to help them out? So I'll go through some of those sorts of issues with you tonight and talk about some of the types of birds that are found in those places. And it's not an isolated issue. This is not something that occurs just in Portland and Seattle. But instead, this sort of setting where you have a moderate amount, say somewhere between 30 and 70% of the natural or some sort of vegetation relative to purely built areas occurs around all of the major cities across the U.S. And certainly, for the most part, up in here, we've got our two cities, and then down the West Coast, but an awful lot of the eastern half of the U.S. is in this sort of suburban settlement, where you have a mixture of forest that was perhaps native to the area. You've got built areas, you've got ponds and grasslands that are put in, lots of different sorts of habitats close together in these built areas, and that's why we have this high diversity. You bring a lot of different resources in close proximity, and the animals that use those also gather into that close proximity, and when you go out and count them, you see a lot of different ones there. That sort of relationship's been found in not only in places on the West Coast, but in the Midwest and also the East, and in Japan, and in most temperate areas around the world. Where it hasn't been found thus far, and I don't think it will be, is in tropical settings. And in those areas, the forested areas have such high diversity that any reduction in that land cover tends to reduce diversity, at least up to a point. But it hasn't been well studied in those sorts of places either. So it's kind of the future of things to do. That brings us to what kinds of animals are in those different areas. So when I show you the high diversity in the middle of that graph, it's not the same birds that are found on either end of that graph for the most part. There's some of both, actually, in the Seattle and Portland area, I would assume. But what we typically have is on that far right end, where it's mostly forest, we have these sorts of species, ones we call avoiders, like that tapir that I showed you to start with. These are animals that require extensive natural habitat, native habitat where they evolved, and relatively light human presence. So for us here, one of these signature birds is the black-throated gray warbler that you have here as well. The hairy woodpecker is also one of these birds. They do occur further into developed areas, but they really do best out in the predominantly forested areas. And then if you're in other parts of the world, in Europe, maybe a wryneck or a jackdaw or a nightingale might be the sort of species that would be responding negatively to virtually any kind of development. In the middle part of that graph, the most dominant group of birds we call adapters. And these are birds that really do well there. They thrive in those settings, it appears. And they are found over a broad range of places. They're very generalist in their diet, their nest placement, and things like that. They can handle a lot of what we throw at them. A lot of what changes in that slide I showed you of a development going on, they can handle the shrubs that come in once the forest is cleared, for example, or the feeders. So in the Midwest, the northern cardinal is a great example of this. Here, the white-crowned sparrow, eastern part of the states, the black-billed magpie, or in Europe, the robin. The great tit in Europe, but here would be the black-capped chickadee, same sort of species taking on this role. An interesting one in Europe is the goshawk. Same species we have here that's so threatened by our presence and our reduction of native forests thrives in the cities of Europe, the biggest cities there. Here would be the Cooper's hawk, smaller version of the goshawk that does extremely well in our cities and suburbs. And then finally, we have another group that would be way over on this side of that curve I showed you, the ones that really utilize the places where we are most abundant. They're the species that commonly have house or barn or human in their name. Okay, so barn swallows and house finches, barn owls, and some of the introduced species like parrots that are found now in many different cities, including Portland, around the world. And crows. Here's the hooded crow from Europe, but it could be the American crow here that takes on this role. So these are species that are rarely found far from people. In our setting, and in yours, the reason we get that high diversity in the middle is because we certainly attract some of these species into our settled areas. We keep some of the avoiders in there as well, and we have a lot of these adapters that fill in as well. So you add all three of those together, the sum of the additions are greater than the losses of the avoiders in our forest, and we end up with high diversity there that drops again when you get to places that are mostly avoiders in the forested end of that study. Does that all make sense? Okay. Now, the realization that cities can hold great diversity of birds is not something particularly new. John Burroughs wrote about it back in the 1800s, where he would talk about traveling through the forest to find the greatest, neatest places to see all the birds he could see. And he said he was usually disappointed. And instead, he'd get into the small cities and suburbs there, and he'd find great diversity there. And that's where he actually was most stimulated by the diversity of birds. In London, for example, in the early 1800s, there was about 25 or 30 species regularly found in inner London. And in the late 1800s, W.H. Hudson, who was an early bird naturalist there, commented that, you know, it's unfortunate there are so few birds here now, and it's almost certain to drop from here on out. But when people have surveyed this more recently, like Cramp in the 80s, he found that actually it was a lot different. And the number of species in London, inner London, has increased steadily since the 1800s, from 25 birds up to almost 80 species now regularly found there. So again, it's this mix of adapters and exploiters that are balancing out the loss or compensating for the loss of some of these avoiders. So I want to tell you a little bit about the sort of place, the sort of interactions these animals have around us. And I want to stress the fact that what we're really dealing with here is a very rich ecological web. And one of the species that illustrates that for us tonight is the red-bellied sapsucker. And these animals, as you know here, they drill sap wells in trees, sometimes in ornamental trees that you don't want them to drill these holes in. But they do it anyway, because that's what sapsuckers do. The sap flows there. They eat the sap, but they also eat a lot of the insects and other animals that are attracted to it that also utilize this resource that's provided by their presence. Even a lot of squirrels, red squirrels, the native red squirrels, will eat the sap that is provided by these sapsucker workings. But more importantly, they also drill holes like other woodpeckers. And those holes are used by secondary cavity nesters. So things like the chickadees, the black-capped chickadees or chestnut-backed chickadees that we have here, they utilize those, or nuthatches, bluebirds in some places. And those animals are able, they're facilitated really by the presence of these cavity nesters like this that drill these holes for others to use. Even other species like mice and bats will use some of the cavities created by these sorts of animals. So they're very important in laying out this web that these animals utilize. And most importantly for us to all understand is that we are an absolute fundamental functional part of this web in our suburban and urban areas. And as an example of that is our provisioning of food for many species, but especially here, the Anna's hummingbird. And we put out feeders for Anna's hummingbirds, and now they live not only here year-round, but in Seattle and north of Seattle year-round. And that's a recent thing. Only in the last few decades have those birds remained year-round there. It's entirely due to our activities, our part in this ecological web, that we are wound together with this species and others in and around our yards. Sometimes this feeding of birds gets pretty crazy. So I want to divert a little bit here and talk about crows, one of my favorite topics. And a study that we did in Seattle that looked at people that specialize on feeding crows, basically, and how the crows specialize on those people. And they have a very tight relationship. This woman is sitting here. These crows have gotten some peanuts from her. They expect her every day to come to that particular bench. They, in fact, meet her as soon as she steps out of her office, and they accompany her down there. They fly over her head, dive down low, and tap her sometimes on the head or the shoulder, and then land in front of her like, okay, where's the peanuts? And that's their routine. That's the bird's routine, and that's her routine. Again, very tight, coupled relationship. Who trained who? Exactly, just like a dog. The question of who trained who is even more impressive in this example from Sweden. In a previous book that Tony Angell and I did on crows, what we related here was a woman who, again, was enamored with the magpies, another crow relative in her yard. And she saw that as she fed them a little bit in the winter, that they seemed to kind of follow her movements through the windows. And she'd look out, and they'd be looking in at her, and she thought, wow, that was kind of neat. So she'd throw a little food to them, and they'd eat that. And she didn't feed them a lot. It wasn't regular, but enough that they started to pay more attention, tapping on the window as she went by. Okay, more food. Finally, the doorbell rings, as is shown here. These birds learned to depress the tongue of the lion doorbell ringer to get her attention, and they did this when they saw her inside. Of course, she came out and gave him a load of food at that point. Her husband was not so keen on this idea at all, and as I talked to him, he said that at one point, he acted as if he threw something at these magpies. From that day on, they whitewashed his car window every morning. He had to clean his car before he could drive to work. He tried switching places with his wife's car. They'd have nothing of it. The magpies always got his. So when you get entwined in this ecological web that is your yard, be careful, okay? It's a tight web, and it will bite you if you're not careful with it. So I want to tell you a little bit about our research in Seattle, and I'm going to introduce you to a bit of data, not too much, but also just a protocol that we did there, basically. And that is to compare the birds and their survivorship and reproduction and abundance in three different settings. So we have these forested reserves. For example, areas here that the green here are forested places, the gray are developed areas, places that are surrounded by quite large forests. I'll show you a picture of that in a second. And then standard developed subdivisions, anywhere from 30 to 70 or 80 year old subdivisions. And then ones I'll talk about a lot are what we call developing or changing landscapes. These are ones that we went out and we looked 15 years ago for the signs that developers would put up or the county would put up and say, something's going to happen here. There's a land use action that's going to happen. Be ready. So we went in there and started counting birds and doing surveys in those areas when those signs first went up. And then we tried to continue as the development occurred. So we can follow the track of the birds through these places that are forest at the beginning of our study and development at the end of our study. So here's just some pictures of those. Here's a reserve place. This little polygon is where we count our birds. And next to that is a large planned subdivision in the Seattle area, Issaquah area, if you're familiar with that, that's going in. And we studied birds here. And at this point, the development had just started, and it would push this way during our study. This would be a changing or developing landscape. And then a standard subdivision that was in place at the start of our study, where we would follow birds in the little forested places around there. So again, think of yourself as a bird. The change in these developing landscapes is rapid and it's extreme. Here's a couple of our points in 2000 and the next year, or 2 years later, 2002, this is what those same places look like when we took a photo from the same area. So if you're a bird using this snag, it's gone. Or if you're using the vegetation here for nesting, you're now looking at lawn. What do you do in that particular setting? First off, I want to show you how the abundance of some of the avoiders and adapters change when these sorts of things happen. So I'll walk you through this graph. This is the most complex data you're going to have to process tonight. So hang in there. We'll get through it. What you're going to see here are the abundance of, in this case, the Pacific wren, one of the most abundant birds. It's certainly one of your most abundant as well in forested settings. It's a classic avoider. Its abundance is very high in the green bars here, which are the reserves where we studied them across many years. So they're very abundant there, and the gray bars are the developments. They're not so abundant there. But what we see that's interesting is that if you go to those changing landscapes, the red stars in this case, and you start off at the beginning of our study, the abundance of wrens was exactly as you would expect in a reserve, okay? Because it's mostly forest. So they're right there with the reserves, and through time, their abundance drops to be exactly what you'd expect in a development. So that process of development has caused the change in abundance of wrens, driven it down to be what you'd expect in a typical development, pretty rare. The opposite is seen with juncos, which are a classic adapter. And they start off, again, being fairly rare in our study sites that change because, and that's the same as they would be rare in a reserve. All these green bars are fairly low numbers of juncos. They're not super abundant there. They're much more abundant in the gray areas, the places that are developed already. In our changing spots, they start off low, and juncos increase in abundance through time so that they're just like you would expect them to be in a development by the end of our study. So we have causal relationships. It's not rocket science. I mean, we kind of expected that, right? But it's nice to be able to quantify and at least see they are absolutely responding as a population through time to that change in the landscape, because it is extreme. Well, more interesting is what happens to individual birds. So our strategy was while we were counting them, we would also try to catch as many as we could. And that's, to me, that's the only reason I do this work. I mean, it's fun to go out and count birds, but I really like to catch birds. So here's a picture of a towhee in my hand. And towhees are great birds. We set up mist nets, they're called, for them. And these nets are hard to see. In fact, occasionally you catch a bicycler or a coyote or all kinds of different things in these suburban areas in your mist nets. But you set them up before it gets light and in places where you expect the birds to be, and sometimes you do a playback of that species' call to attract them to the area. And that was the case here. This was a spotted towhee that we had color bands on before. I banded him several years before, but he had lost the color band from this leg. So each of these birds has color bands that are individually distinct so we can identify them without catching them. But they also have a metal band that has a number that's registered with the federal government, the Bird Banding Lab, for those of you who know that. And now that's like a Social Security number for each bird. There's only one number for any given bird. So I couldn't tell who this guy was just by looking at him. I had to catch him again. Got him drawn into the net. He came into the calls that I was playing, and he's running down the net as a towhee will do, and he almost got out, but I fortunately got him right before he did. Got a look at his band, and sure enough, it was the male that had been there for the past 3 years, and I was able to reband and then follow him for the next 4 years. So by the end of our study here, I'd watched this guy for 7 years. He had had three different female mates over the course of his life. He had produced young with all of them. And by the time we count up, he had fledged from his activities that we know of at least six individual towhees that survived. So he was a very successful towhee in a suburban setting. And he was, like I said, we had followed him 7 years. He was at least 2 years old when we banded him. So 9 year old for a songbird smaller than a robin. But even those wrens, the Pacific wrens that we studied too, birds less than 10 grams, we've got individuals of those that have lasted for 5 or 6 years. So the survivorship of most of these birds is short, but some of them really hang on for quite a long time in these settings. Their survivorship, actually, this is the most complex slide, sorry. The other one, you thought the other one was bad, wait till you get a load of this one. It's not too bad. But what this shows is just the annual survivorship. What proportion of birds live to see the next year of those we banned? So that's what's shown here, from none of them surviving to all of the individuals surviving, 100% surviving. And it's a function, survivorship in animals, including birds, is a function of their body size. So these are small to large birds. And this line and the confidence limits around it that are shown here are the average expectation for a typical songbird living elsewhere. So a study that was done with lots of different birds from all around the world. And what we see with our dotted individuals here, the birds that we studied, for example, the Pacific wren, that avoider, the survivorship in the red and green areas, those reserves and changing landscapes that started off to be pretty forested, they're right up about where you'd expect them to be for a small bird of their size, okay? Not so in the developments. And that's probably why their abundance declined in the developments and is low in standard developments. Adult survivorship is compromised for these wrens in those places. I'm not going to show you the data, but I can tell you that reproduction is not compromised in our setting for those particular individuals. But adult survivorship seems to be. And the junco shows the opposite relationship. Here's the dots for the junco, and you see that their survivorship in a reserve, or sorry, in a development, is right about what you'd expect again for a bird of its size. And that's where that bird does very well. It's abundant there, and it increased in our study areas that were forested to start with, all forest or changing ones, it increased in abundance as those forests became more developed, right? So again, a lot of the changes in abundance that we saw that I showed you on that previous slide are tied to changes in adult survivorship. So when I come back to some suggestions, a lot of them are going to revolve around what can we do to maintain adult survivorship, because that seems to be important for maintaining the abundance of these birds. All right, well, when I was a kid, I'm sure some of you guys had this same conversation. When I was a kid, there was a development going in next to my house in Kansas. And when I was growing up there, my dad was involved in the development. And I asked him, I said, you know, what's going to happen with things like the deer that we enjoyed seeing or some of the other birds that we enjoyed seeing there? What's going to happen when their territories are taken out with this development? Where are they going to go? And he said very confidently, oh, they'll just find another place. They'll move. Don't worry about it. You know, and he wasn't so glib about it, but he was like, it'll be all right. You know, they'll find a place to live. So we have the data now to be able to actually address my dad's answer and see if he was right. And so if we look at things like the Pacific wren, again, that avoider that survives poorly in developed areas, here's an example of what a bird, a wren's territory looked like in 2003. It was in this territory in prior years when it was all forest. And in 2003, it lost about a third of its territory's forest to this development that was going in. It was a marked bird, and we could then ask, what happened to it? Did it disappear? Well, a lot of them do, but in this case, we were able to find this bird. Here's his new territory, 650 meters away, which is a long haul for a bird this big, right, to get over there. Got to a new territory that was all forested. And in general, what we see are these avoiders move. We lose track of a lot of them. It's like finding a needle in the haystack with adult birds once they're no longer where you've seen them banded. But we searched widely for them, and we were lucky enough to find many of them. And the Swainson's thrush and Pacific wrens are the avoiders that we studied most, and they indeed picked up and moved, and they got territories and were successful elsewhere. They did, their survivorship was low, so some of those that moved also died along the way. A very different story happens when we look at the adapters. So here's a song sparrow. In particular, this is a song sparrow number 1861-78683. Familiar to all of you, I'm sure. Here's his territory in 2005, and it was, again, about a quarter of it cleared in 2006, this quarter right here, to facilitate a new road and cul-de-sac coming in. That bird just stayed right there, did not move. It was 28 meters in this year, apart from the center place where it was in the prior year. And it, in this case, did not breed successfully, but it did eventually breed successfully again there. But the interesting thing is that for towhees and song sparrows, the ones we have big samples on, and even Buick's wrens, they tend to stay right there when development occurs and take advantage, really, of the new setting that's created there, the shrubs that will grow up or the feeders that will come in association with those houses. So avoiders leave. Sometimes they find a new spot. Adapters stay there and ride it out. Well, they don't all just either stay or go. Some of them actually evolve to take advantage of our offerings. So this is a very rare species. I'm sure you've never seen a Brewer's blackbird here. But I'm sure you have. They're great birds. They're very common. To me, the ultimate habitat, the optimal habitat for a Brewer's blackbird is a Costco parking lot. They love the shrubs along the edges of that. They walk around the carts and the cars. They never seem to get hit. I don't know how that is possible, but they don't. And what's really cool is that as I started watching them a little more closely, I'd go and I'd see, you know, try to find out where they're nesting, what's going on here. And when I'd go early before the store opened, which I figured was the best time to study them, they weren't around. It's like, where are the birds? They're not here. So I'd wait, and a few minutes before the store would open, that's when they would show up. They'd start coming in and gathering. They would, in fact, queue up right at the door of the Costco by where I live and wait for the doors to open. They would beat the first shoppers into Costco. As soon as the door opened, bam, they flew in. They go right to the cafe, start eating pizza crust, stay out of the rain, no traffic to deal with there. Great place for a Brewer's blackbird. So they've started to adapt their behavior to our schedule and our activities. And that's kind of the first step in evolving to live with us in these new settings. And they're quite a exploiter, really. The junco, the dark-eyed junco, is another species that has evolved, in this case, not just its behavior, but its plumage, to be different in suburban areas than in urban areas, or sorry, than in wildland areas. This is a cool story. It's done by Pamela Yeh, who used to be at Portland State. She was at San Diego when she did this work, and it's really a great study that shows how the tail of the junco, the number of white feathers in the outer part of their tail, this is the snowbird you see at your feeders flicking its tail around, that has changed in suburban areas to be less white, fewer white feathers, than in wildland areas. And the story goes that in wildland areas, what a junco has to do, a male junco, with these white tail feathers is basically to use it as an aggressive signal to other males to stay away, that I'll chase you out of my territory. It's a defensive pre-aggression sort of signal. And that works great in a wildland area where you're probably only going to breed once or maybe twice in that season because it's harsh and either it dries up or it gets too cold and the birds leave. And the females want males in that case that will stay and defend the territory well and not. It doesn't matter so much how much they contribute to rearing their young. But in a suburban setting, a female junco might get 4 or 5 nests out in a given year because of the heat island effect we have. The breeding season is longer. There's more food available from feeders. And these birds now put a selective premium, the females, put a selective premium on males that don't flash their tails and fight all the time, but instead stick around the territory and help rear the young. So they can raise more young, contribute to more broods in that particular year. So on average, the number of white tail feathers in a Junco's tail is 2.5 in a suburban setting and 3 in a wildland setting. And presumably that number would shrink as that sort of selection continued. So a pretty cool effect of female selection, in this case for mates, on the traits that are inherited also by the young of those particular males. And it's not only morphology that's changing, but also the voice of urban birds. So birds that live close to any of them that live close to I-5 tonight, or as it was starting to get dark, they were having a hard time communicating with all the low-frequency noise of cars and buses going by. That's basically mass low-frequency communication in a lot of urban settings. And birds like this noisy miner from Australia sing at higher pitch, they sing louder, they sing at the time of day when traffic is at a lull versus during the rush hour commute. They've changed a lot of their behaviors and voice patterns so that they can be heard over the din, basically. So they can communicate as to their territory and also attract mates through their voice. So there's a variety of changes, and in some cases, we can even trace these to the creation of new species. The black-capped warbler in England is evolving a new strain that migrates a shorter distance and has a different morphology because it feeds on feeders in England instead of going down to olive groves in northern Africa to winter. The sparrows that I'm going to talk about here have, through hybridization, formed a new species, and that hybridization was facilitated by our activities as an early people. So the house sparrow is a species you're familiar with here. We've got them all over the US. They're, of course, native to Europe, and they're native to Northern Europe. And they didn't really come into the Italian peninsula until about 5,000 or 6,000 years ago when people started crossing the Alps. And as they crossed the Alps, these sparrows came along with them. They just followed like pigeons would. They're a real commensal of human activity. And people would start to move down south into Italy, and a few house sparrows would come with them. But there weren't enough house sparrows to really allow them to form a breeding population among just house sparrows. So they started breeding, interbreeding with Spanish sparrows, which were very common in all throughout Italy at that time. And through that process, they produced these hybrids that have the kind of the top part of the head, the crown like a Spanish sparrow, and the bib like a house sparrow. And these hybrids would, over time, as house sparrows stayed up north and Spanish sparrows became more abundant south, they increased in abundance and they would start breeding with one another. And so this attraction for the same looking type of mate that you are led to the creation, basically, of a group of hybrid individuals that had unique characteristics and were genetically now isolated from both parents. So we now have the Italian sparrow, thanks to early humans traversing the Alps and bringing some house sparrows to breed with Spanish sparrows and create this new species that now is the most common species in Italy of these types of sparrows. So sometimes we're very destructive. And that's what we always hear. We're a destructive species, and we are, frankly. But sometimes we're creative as well, and our activities can increase biological diversity as well as they can decrease it. Sometimes it's just the beauty that gets you to really look and see what's out in your backyard. And to me, nothing is more beautiful really than a Swainson's thrush and as it builds its nest. And I hadn't mentioned earlier, I'm sorry, but the illustrator of all the illustrations you've seen and the ones in the book is Jack DeLapp. He's one of my graduate students. He's not only a scientist that's collected a lot of the data that I've been talking about, but he's a fabulous artist as well, as you can see in this rendering he did of a Swainson's thrush lining its nest with the skeletalized leaves of alder, which is what their final layer inside their nest is. Whenever you find a Swainson's nest, you know it is because of that layer of leaves inside. So beautiful nest, moss on the outside, great leaf surroundings on the inside. Really something to behold when you're lucky enough and you've got enough salmonberry in your yard, which is what they like to nest in, then you can find these sorts of nests. Okay, so we've got a diversity of species here. Some of them are quite interesting species. Some of them are pretty common. They're adapting to us. They're entwining us in this ecological web. And I think it's worth trying to preserve that diversity and enhance that diversity in the places where we live, where we work, and where we play. So I want to give you some suggestions for how we could do that. And I think most of these will be very familiar to any of you that are bird watchers for sure. This is not going to be anything new, but it's maybe a way to put it together and I want to talk about things in kind of three areas. What can we do for habitat? How can we make that safer? Because remember, adult survivorship was quite important to abundance of these birds. Then how can we instill people to wonder and care about these birds? Habitat. First thing. So actually, I have these as 10 commandments, but for tonight, they'll just be 10 ideas we can talk about, all right? Do not covet your neighbor's lawn. It's the first one. Really, the lawn is the greatest ecological disaster known to man, as far as I'm concerned. This is an area that has reduced the biological diversity of great swaths of land, and it's something that we always pride ourselves on, this great lawn, but what we should start priding ourselves on is reducing it a bit. A little lawn's great. A soccer pitch is important for the neighborhood and these sorts of things, but reduce it wherever you can is my message. And the best way to reduce it is to plant native shrubs like salmonberry around here to fill in some of the edges there. Just the amount of gasoline spilled every year by people filling up their lawnmowers in the United States is equal to the amount that was spilled in the Exxon Valdez accident. In 12 years, it equals the amount spilled in the Deepwater Horizon accident. Amazing, but just a few drops by millions of people every few weeks or week leads to that sort of total of wasted fuel in this case. I decided to quit mowing my lawn this last year. My wife was not really happy with this to start with. It's grown on her. I've gotten by with it. And what resulted was this, was what is actually technically called a freedom lawn, which I think is a great name for it, because I was free from mowing and doing anything else on this lawn. And we have a pretty small lawn to begin with, but what was cool is all these flowers came up that I had no idea were there. I don't even know what these purple things are. They're certainly not native, but they are an interesting resource. It allowed for lots of pollinators. Lots of native bumblebees were in this particular patch. Juncos nesting along the edge. So just leaving things alone a little bit, it looks kind of ratty and raggedy, and fortunately, my neighbors can't see into my yard, so they didn't give me any static about it, and that's certainly an issue. But it's a great way to reduce your workload and really sit back and enjoy what nature brings into this sort of setting. And then you can mow it and have it look nice for the year. Another important thing with habitat is to provide food and nest boxes. Some people will raise controversy about feeding birds. I think it's very beneficial. The British Trust for Ornithology suggests you do it year-round. So the consensus, I think, among ornithologists is that it's a beneficial thing for the species that utilize it. They don't become addicted to these foods or anything like that. You don't need to do it all the time, full bore, like some of the people that have crows that follow them around by any means. But providing food allows those adapters and exploiters to maintain large populations. And large populations are essential if a species is going to evolve towards the stresses or in response to the stresses that we put out there. So having a large population is more resilient and allows these animals to adapt. Nest boxes and even dead trees on your property, most important. If you could do one thing on your property, get rid of a little bit of grass, cut the top off of one of your trees, or when one dies, leave it there. And you'll be amazed at the sorts of things that come in. This is a tree, a snag, we call them, that I made in my yard that we cut off. And I had three pileata woodpeckers on it in this particular time. But fabulous bird. You know it here. It's the biggest extant woodpecker in North America. And they are very adaptable to our suburban areas. And especially if we have suet feeders out that they will feed on and places for them to drill their nests, which can be done with some of these. Either the best thing is to leave a dead tree because it has the appropriate fungus in it that allows them to find a safe place to drill a hole. But even if you make a tree, they will forage in it like crazy. And hopefully, I'm hoping it's 12 years now that they'll eventually, the tree will soften up enough that they can drill a hole in it, but not yet. Another important thing is not just to provide the same sort of habitat everywhere, but to mix it up. It's all right to have some areas that are, you know, primarily lawns, and some areas that are shrubby, and some areas that are forested. That mixture is what led to that diversity that I told you about in terms of richness of species. The last thing we want are to have all the subdivisions basically end up looking the same. And that's a pretty common trend now. I know if you've flown from Seattle or Portland down to San Diego, it basically looks the same underneath a lot of that route. And the same snaking patterns in the roads and little bits of forest here and there or shrub here and there in San Diego. That similarity is going to reduce overall diversity. And it's an issue called biological or biotic homogenization that ecologists are concerned about. So the more variable we can make our subdivisions and the places within suburban or urban settings, the more variety we can maintain. The more natural that vegetation is, the more we can maintain the natural birds that would be there. So we don't end up with the same species in Phoenix and Tucson, San Diego, and Portland. That's what we want to try to avoid. So keep trees here and keep desert there, and we'll maintain a lot of those native species. Even within a place, by maintaining a variety, we can have two species of wrens here. The Pacific wren, the avoider that I told you about, if there are places that are large forested areas, they will survive there. And if the open areas, they'll be colonized by house wrens or Buick's wrens, in our case, in Seattle. When those places get close together, Buick's wrens come in and kick out Pacific wrens as well. So that can be a problem. But in places where you've got big chunks of both sorts of habitat, both species can occur. Highways and connections, as I'll show in the next one, between terrestrial and aquatic places are essential to maintain. And Portland and Seattle are really leaders on doing this. The kind of work you guys were talking about earlier is exactly the sort of thing that's really important to maintain species, not so much birds. I mean, they will utilize that, but especially the other animals that live with us, like salamanders or snakes or frogs, they can't fly across our roadways. So there are a lot of creative solutions to making passageways for big animals. You've seen, I'm sure, these great things in Canada and proposed around here for landscapes to be able to cross cross across I-5, for example, or I-90, and allow caribou and things to walk across. But if you've ever been to Palo Alto and driven around there, you might have noticed some bumps in the road as you went along. And those little bumps were just small pipes that went under the ground that were put there for salamanders to move between their breeding ponds and the upland places where they live the rest of the year. In New Jersey, where this image is from that Jack did, a spotted salamander there, the people there notice these great migrations of these salamanders every spring as they're going into the breeding ponds. And a lot of them are getting slaughtered by cars. And they just took it on their own accord and shut down the roads. And they have a block party, basically, every evening during the migration season now. Watch these animals cross, maybe have a beer or two, and keep the roads closed so that they're not smashed. It's pretty easy to make these adjustments. Like I said, connecting especially aquatic and terrestrial places is critically important for animals like those salamanders. All right, let's talk about survivorship. The most deadly force on the planet when it comes to a bird is the cat, the domestic cat. The cat that's outside, whether it's feral or it's a house cat that's let outside, they eat, in the United States alone, the best estimates are between 2 and 3.7 billion birds a year. That's 1 in 10 birds a year eaten, killed by cats. I wouldn't even say they're eaten, but killed by free-ranging cats, okay? So if you've got a cat, keep it inside. If you get a young cat, they tame down quite well to living inside. They live twice as long inside as far as compared to outside, so it's a good thing for the cat as well, and it's a really great thing for a variety of the birds. Even their presence outside, if they don't catch them, they scare birds off from attending their nests, and nest survivorship goes down in those particular cases. A lot of studies on that going on now. The editor that I work with sent me this picture after she was convinced she's got to keep her cat inside. Her cat died. She got a new cat, started from day one having it on a leash. I've also seen recently on the web there are now places you can go cat hiking with your cat outside on a leash. So that may be the new strategy. Train your young kitty to be on the leash and under your control so it's not going to be grabbing the birds, but it can still explore and do its thing. You know, they like to be out there for sure. The next most important source of mortality for birds are collisions with windows. And even though it's tremendous in downtown areas like here, especially during migration time, the greatest mortality occurs right in our neighborhoods because there's so many more buildings and windows there than are concentrated in cities. So about 500,000 birds per year die in the U.S. by collisions with windows. Windows like this, big ones that are not, they don't have a lot of subdivisions. Killer windows. And there's a variety of things that can be done. Some of the simplest things are just to put UV reflective stickers on them. Birds see in UV. I'm sure you can get these stickers from Portland Audubon here, but also a variety of places, bird shops. You have to put quite a few of them, about every 6 or 8 inches along your window, But fortunately, we don't see that great in UV, and those stickers are not super obstructive to us. I've got them on my windows now. They're not bad. I don't mind them. I like to look out my windows, as you might guess. But there is well worth it. It definitely reduces mortality. And over the years, and as the economics go that way, we may see windows that have UV film put on them right from the start. They're working on those sorts of things now, but the economics aren't there yet to make it happen. Here's just an example from New Orleans. I was at the airport there, and here's a really reflective window. Looks a lot like this one. And here's a palm tree that's on the outside of that window just reflected in. So you can see a bird being confused, flying to go to that tree. So keeping vegetation close to the windows also helps, and that birds will land there rather than just cruise through. And right underneath this window, I found 12 dead birds, including several warblers and thrushes. So they're not also, there's a different group of species that cats get. Cats will get a lot of the birds that forage on the ground, around feeders and other places. And windows get fast flyers and migrants, but especially fast flying thrushes and other migrants at night that are attracted to the light. Which brings to the next notion, and that is to reduce lighting of places at night, wherever we can. Obviously, we need some light for safety. I needed my lights to get here tonight for sure, but we don't need stadiums illuminated all night. We don't need office buildings illuminated all night when nobody's in them. And in fact, a lot of cities, I don't know, has Portland done a lights out campaign? Does anybody know? Working on it. So is Seattle. I don't know how these two cities could not have done this yet. If Chicago did it, you know, God, well, I know we could do this, but basically get businesses to turn off lights during the migration season anyway in the big skyscrapers, which cause migrants that are flying at night to be disoriented by that light and crash into those buildings. So it's a pretty simple thing. It saves energy as well. And if you've got lights around your place, you can have them be the yellow color lights are better than bright blue or sharp lights. Those are less disruptive of not just attracting birds, but just disrupting the animals that live and cruise around at night. They're out in the dark for a reason. It's safe. And when we illuminate an area, we basically reduce their habitat by making it too light. So there are a variety of things you can do to reduce your input in that way or effect in that way. Valuing native predators is another thing that's hard to do. It's hard enough with some, we were talking, Tim and I, about wolves before. I don't know if we'll ever come to the point where we value those predators, but in our yards, some people have a hard time valuing the Coopers or Sharp Shin Hawk that comes in and grabs their prized goldfinch on the feeder. To me, it's sad when that happens, but to me, it's the best sign of a healthy ecosystem that you could have. That shows right there that you've got a full trophic web. You've got prey and you've got predators and they're working things out. Okay, that's part of nature. That's a selection that goes on to change coloration or behavior or activity of these birds. And it's important to celebrate it as much as it is to, you know, to load the loss of life that you see as well. In this case, you know, loving crows as they're going after a red-tailed hawk and valuing the red-tailed hawk as well. Not an easy thing to do in these settings, but an important one. And especially one of the worst things that has unintended consequences are some of the poisons we put out for rodents in particular, which are definitely an issue if you've got bird feeders around. And so not doing that so that poison doesn't trickle into the food system for some of these other animals like red tails that are eating the mice or the great horned owl in my yard that ate a cottontail two nights ago. You know, it's like, great, one less cottontail to eat our garden, but certainly not something you want to have tainted with these poisons. So finally, the last thing I want to come back to is that connection with the tapir. And really, I think this, again, is one of the most important aspects of why it's important to understand what's around your yard as an ecological community and to value it as well. And This name is actually, it's got a formal name in the scientific literature. It's called the pigeon paradox. And the paradox is that we have to be able to enjoy things as simple, as sometimes pesky as people see pigeons to be, if we're going to indeed value nature in generally. So this image from Costa Rica of kids out feeding pigeons and feeding squirrels that are in the park there, they're not, some of them not even native species, but these kids are engaged with life. And they're engaged with valuing another species' life. And I would hope that as they do that, as they become enthralled with, why do those pigeons together? Why is there a group instead of just one? Why are they different colors? What about those behaviors and sounds we hear? They start to get more interested in general animal behavior or ecological relationships, and they start to value that. They're willing to vote for conservation measures. They're willing to sacrifice and put aside areas, places, for example, where that tapir needed to leave. So I think building that wonder and that care in an urban area is a really great step into producing a wider land ethic. And this land ethic, of course, is something that, oh, too bad, some weird thing. This would say Aldo Leopold under here, because Aldo Leopold said this. And of course, he articulated a land ethic in the 30s. But it's just as relevant now as it was in the 30s. And he basically makes the point that we abuse land because we regard it as a commodity. And especially in a suburban and urban area, it is a tremendously important commodity. Okay, it's a big investment for all of us. But what Leopold said was that we would start to love and use this land with respect if we valued it not just as a commodity, but as a community. And I think that's what I've tried to instill in you tonight, is that this group of animals that lives around you on your land, it's their habitat as well. They are part of the community, you're part of that community with them. And as we start to value that part of our land, we will get economic benefits from it as well, but we also get an ecological benefit that'll last for a long time. So with that, I would thank you for your attention. Sorry for the screw up with the words on that, but I'm glad to answer questions if you've got some on this or other things. Thank you very much. Yep.
Your work here seems to be focused on forests and yes. Human communities. Has anybody done any comparable work with human communities moving out into farmland?
You know, he said, my work's focused mainly on forests, which it is. And have people done similar things with respect to farmland and the reforestation of farmland, basically, with a lot of people moving there, a lot more of these adapting species, adapters and exploiters occurring in those settings as well. But I think the Midwest, there have been studies done, so at least it was former farmland, which, you know, a lot of times the way it goes is we have farmland and then that's the nice flat area, so that's what's developed next. And so a lot of the developments that have been looked at in Ohio, for example, were former farmlands that have been studied. It's interesting you ask that. I'm actually going to try to focus more on that myself the next few years, is more what's going on now with small-scale farms and how the diversity there relates to large-scale farms. I think we'll see the exact same thing. It's the same process. You know, small-scale farms have a lot of interesting habitat close together, should get a lot of diversity. Big agro-biz farms are just going to be, you know, wall-to-wall, pretty similar habitat. It's not a turf lawn, but it's a wheat field or whatever. I bet diversity is going to be quite low there. We know from a lot of studies that it is, and that a few species do very, very well there, but most don't. Yeah?
Have you looked at the impact of the cleanup that goes on year-round with blowers and, you know, I'm watching right now where all the leaves are being removed from the yards and all the perennials are being come to the ground?
Yeah. It's a great question. So what happens with just the maintenance in yards? I mean, it's associated again with the cultural norm for what's an aesthetically pleasing yard, right? And that's it's got to all be raked up and cleaned up now. And we haven't looked at that specifically. It kind of falls in the general scheme that these manicured, heavily managed areas, which are mostly turf grass to begin with, that's just another aspect of why they don't support much life year round, for sure. Yeah. You know, some animals use them at different parts of the natural cycle, but nothing really is there year round and uses just that habitat. Some of it's because of the disturbance of mowing and the other aesthetics you mentioned, the pesticides and herbicides that are used on them. But to specifically focus on that, nobody has that I know of, no. Yeah.
You find it, non-native species such as the European starling have an impact on the more attractive species that we like in our suburbs?
Yeah, that's a great question. Do starlings have a negative impact on the native species that are there? And the short answer is no, they don't. There have been a study done by Walt Koenig in, he was at Berkeley, and basically Walt compared all the studies done on the positive and negative effects of starlings on native woodpeckers and secondary cavity nesters. That's where you'd expect to have the effect. He found one case where it's a pretty good negative relationship where starlings reduce the ability of red-bellied woodpeckers to survive in some areas. So, and they have very similar size holes, similar nest hole requirements. They also compete with flickers in our area here, and in our study, they're the one of the sources of loss of flicker nest sites is usurpation by starlings. But it's pretty minor. What we found, actually, I've got a student, the paper's ready to go, part of his dissertation, and what we found is that starlings are in buildings and in human-made areas for the most part. They don't venture very far into the natural areas around Seattle. And instead, the secondary cavity nesters that are in the natural areas venture quite far into the suburban and urban areas and utilize those same sorts of things that starlings are using. So that doesn't, their effect doesn't seem to spread too far. It's not nearly as bad as we thought 30 years ago or so when it really looked like, wow, this is going to be a disaster. Doesn't seem to be that big of a deal.
Hi. John, our studies overlap to a fair degree, but they also differ. And if I understand yours correctly, you've emphasized more the landscape surrounding particular parks, the amount of forest covered that's there.
Yeah.
I've done that too, but I've focused, I think, a little more on the size of the different parks. And what I've found is that we get the same hump at the intermediate size parks, that's where you get the highest diversity. But the composition of the species at the two ends differ.
Yeah.
And in those really large forest areas, we see a lot of migrants.
Yeah.
And you didn't mention the migrants and how they respond to the outside landscape. Do you have any information on that?
Yeah, I mean, migrants are definitely one of the groups that are mostly avoiders. So the black-throated gray warbler, Wilson's warbler, Swainson's thrush in our area, those are the prime ones, the most abundant ones. And they definitely are much more abundant in our reserve settings as well, the surrounding areas that are mostly forest, for sure. I don't know if it's so much the migratory strategy that's the problem, or it's just that there are typically forest birds here that migrate. Because, you know, the other forest birds, things like red-breasted nuthatches, for example, which are pretty closely tied to Doug fir forests around here. They don't really, I mean, they're in deciduous forests, but not so much. They're able to exploit suburban areas much better, for example, than the migrants because they nest in cavities as opposed to in shrubs or on the ground. One thing we did find that's related to that is that the birds that nest in shrubs in our setting are the ones that really do the worst. The guys on the ground actually do better than the ones in the shrubs, which is kind of different from Eastern studies. And that might be, again, because of the different kind of predators we have or the different migratory composition of those groups. But I think you could equate avoider with migrant, neotropical migrant in our study, and it would be true. They are definitely some of the species that decline in the face of development.
Yeah. So thinking about your species area curve, you were able to do a similar study in a system where subdivisions were going into more primary forests, uh-huh. where you had more of a natural disturbance regime going on, more of a natural patch mosaic. Do you think you would see more of those adapters kind of blending in between suburban landscape and into the forest areas?
Maybe, but it depends on kind of how frequent that disturbance is. It gets back to your comment about how frequent the disturbance is in our areas with leaf blowers or mowing or just carving out new places for houses. It's very fast and much faster and much more interspersed on the landscape than any natural sort of disturbance is. I mean, especially in our west side forest here, where the natural disturbances are winds and things that are, you know, pretty infrequent in terms of opening up lots of big new areas. And so in places, like an Australian scrub sort of habitat where you get a lot of fires every year, you know, reshuffling and creating new openings here and there, you start to get a similar sort of thing. That I bet a lot of adapters would use those areas quite well. And you wouldn't see as big of a change in diversity as you went from that sort of forest to the suburban area, it would be probably pretty similar diversity, and then it would drop in urban areas. But I think the biggest difference from our areas occurs where you have extreme richness, regardless of the disturbance regime, but extreme richness in the primary forest. And we don't have that here. You know, ours are pretty depauperate, really, even relative to the Midwest and East, where it's still not that super diverse relative to the tropics. And when you get these tropical places where you've got huge diversity over very fine scale, you know, few individuals each place, then it's going to be awfully hard to imagine an increase as you open that up to some extent, and not just a straight decrease all the way down. And then the few places where it's been looked at, that is what they found in tropical Mexico and Costa Rica. They've seen that decline.
Yep. I'm just wondering, the introduction of ornamental plants and non-native things in the suburban environment, how is that affecting?
So non-native plants, what are they doing relative to native plants in suburban areas for the birds?
Yeah, because that's what you see in these new developments.
Yeah, it is. And I think, you know, we looked at a couple of different kinds of developments. There's one strategy called a conservation development, where basically you cluster houses together and you maintain the native open space that was there, whether it's forest or field or whatever it was. You maintain that. Those do a lot better than the ones where you go in and scrape it completely, put in new houses, and plant all new non-native things. The non-native shrubs and stuff are still better than grass. A lot of them do provide foods that the native birds use, fruits and things. They don't provide the insect diversity that a lot of the neotropical migrants need, that Mike was saying. So that could be one of the reasons you don't see those as much either. So, I mean, it's not great, but it's better than the alternative. But the best thing, of course, would be to, instead of spending all the effort and money to scrape everything bare and start from scratch, is just to cut out the place where the house is going to go and build there and have covenants that maintain the natural land cover to some extent around those. And Portland and Seattle have a lot of those kind of developments, and they're pretty darn rich, you know, because of that, I think. You are able to keep some of these species that are less likely to stay in a kind of a standard Midwestern subdivision. But it totally depends on what the native habitat is. And in some cases, in grasslands in particular, like around Boulder, Colorado, where it's short grass prairie, typically in the surrounding areas, when we build in those places, we increase the structure of that habitat dramatically with trees, even exotic ones. So you have a big increase in diversity because you've all of a sudden got these birds that can live in trees, but you lose very quickly the birds that are relying upon grassland because their predators are in the trees, for one thing, and of course, you've removed their native grass habitat. So that's where that idea of keeping, you know, in touch with what the native habitat is in the region is so important. So we can keep grassland birds around places like Boulder and desert birds around places like Phoenix. And unfortunately, people seem to want the same landscape, you know, a savanna of trees, which is a different talk that Gordonorians would have to give you about why we want that. But, you know, it's probably deep in our genes to want that sort of thing.
Yeah. You talked about this a little bit with the spotted togi, talking about the male that you caught seeing successive years of breeding. I'm wondering if you're finding that these urban environments are, source populations for the birds, or if, you know, they're potentially just drawing on birds dispersing from nearby forested areas.
Right. So what he's asking about is this idea of a source or a sink or ecological trap, even it's called, where the habitat looks great, the birds pile in there, they eat at the feeder, and they get whacked by Cooper's hawks every day. And so the net result is not sustainable, and that the population growth rate is negative in those places, or is it positive in those places? And we have done that analysis. And basically, they are sources for some species, the adapters, basically, and they are sinks for others, the avoiders. The main reason they're sinks is because of the survivorship on adults, as far as we can tell, for those species. That's the key mechanism, as opposed to increased nest predation, which we see in the Midwest is probably a much more important thing than we have here, at least in our study areas, where the forests, they're not overrun with cats, to be quite honest. There are jays there, there's mice there, there's Cooper's hawks there, but they're not overrun with a bunch of these small mammal predators, which are common in other settings, mainly because of coyotes, which would be the 11th commandment if we could stick one in there, and that is, you know, worship your coyote as the savior of suburban birds. They love cats. They eat a lot of cats.
Feeding birds in urban areas, and I mean, we have bird feeders in our house, but then meanwhile, I'm volunteering in a park where, you know, there's ducks all over the place, and we're trying a campaign supported by Audubon, Portland Parks, to say don't feed the animals. You know, yeah. So it's how do you get that message out that it's okay here and not okay here, and why?
I'd have to be convinced of why it's not okay there. You know, I mean, obviously we don't want animals to be overly dependent and aggressive towards people, which mallards probably can't, but Canada geese could, or certainly swans could. So there could be some reasons like that if we'd explain clearly why this is not a good thing here. You know, enjoy these animals at a distance. When you have things like black bears and cougars coming into areas, of course, you know, it's very important and pretty easy to convince people why you don't want to habituate those animals to our presence, because they're going to have to be killed if they are habituated. So I guess pointing out some of the negative aspects of it, but I didn't put the slide in that shows a bunch of kids feeding Canada geese and mallards in Seattle. And you know, personally, I think it's all right. To me, it allows those people to bond with those birds, to appreciate, hey, there's more than one kind here. And they're gonna spread some disease in doing that. They're going to have some negative effects by that, but is that offset by the positive, you know, perhaps ethic that the kids would develop of, hey, this is a cool animal. You know, I'd like to learn more about those, or I'd like to save those someday. So it's a tough question. I'm sure it would depend on a lot of local settings and particular species we're dealing with, but I hate to see us just tell kids they can't do that, because, you know, they get told that a lot with anything in nature. And I just don't think that's a good thing. I mean, you got to learn by getting bit and getting hit by, you know, a goose wing that, wow, those are strong birds. You know, I better not mess with them. Yeah?
Well, going back to feeding the geese, I think a lot of that problem is what they're feeding the geese. Oh. They tend to feed them bread, and that's what junk food for the birds. It's right. Terrible for the system. They fill up on the bread, and then they don't eat what they need to eat, and they start getting malnourished.
Yeah. So again, that would be a teaching moment that you could say, you know, let's feed them these particular things, not bread. But it's a complex question. I think it's very complex, and it's got, you know, a lot of public health as well as nature deficit kind of questions and issues to it to resolve. And that would be an interesting study in and of itself. Really, what happens to those ducks and geese with bread? What happens to the kids who aren't able to feed them, that are told you can't, don't touch the wildlife, you know, versus those that aren't? That would be a really interesting study to understand how that plays out. If it really has an effect or not, I don't think we know for sure, but it makes sense that it would. One more in the back. That's too bad. I'm sorry about that.
You didn't bring it back to the tapeworm. I think that actually part of what the concern about feeding wildlife, I have a big concern for, especially feeding crows, and the crows are their nest predators on many other species. And I think that an important point is that the suburban environment, we want to make it as good as we possibly can, and then still have those large natural areas where the other species that aren't ever really going to be able to be successful in the city, but still have those.
Yeah, that's a great point. I should have made it stronger. That's absolutely the main message here, is that by building this sort of biophilic relationship between people and animals in a suburban setting, it should translate into making the sacrifice to put those large areas aside where we don't do those sorts of things at all and let natural processes occur there. And the species that just can't tolerate us live there. It's a key thing. And it's not known really how much that, you know, how much you have to be engaged with the nature around you to do that, but I can't help but think it would help with that engagement. And I think there are some studies that suggest that just it has a lot of benefits to us as a species ourselves to value other life, and the aesthetic and stress relief of that sort of activity is huge. I can tell you for the people that feed crows daily around Seattle, their lives would be miserable if they didn't have that outlet of activity, and they've said as much. And they worry what's going to happen when they retire and things like that, you know. But that's an important part of some people's lives, and they have a strong ethic for valuing the things that are necessary to put aside those big areas for rare and sensitive species, for sure. Good point.
Well, thank you, guys. Yep.